All right, well, hello and welcome. I know it's the last kind of show of the festival, and we have a little bit more of an intimate group, which I think is really great. So we'll get a chance to have a good conversation between myself and Jack Jacobs and Dr. Fred Logevall, and I think you're all going to really enjoy it. Very, very, very briefly about myself, I'm Major Josh Silver. I'm an officer in the United States Army. I'm here as a uniform representative on behalf of the Command General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. And of course, the views I express are my own and not that of the Department of Defense, the Army, or any of its subordinate commands. But the truth is I'm joined by really some very, very distinguished individuals, and I'm glad to be speaking with them. First, Dr. Fredrik Logevall, he teaches at Harvard, an acclaimed author on the Vietnam War in the many decades of that conflict spanned, to include his Pulitzer Prize-winning book, Embers of War, which I truly enjoyed. And sitting on his right is Colonel Jack Jacobs, who, as you all know, is a Congressional Medal of Honor winner from Vietnam, but also an extremely successful businessman and a political analyst. So I think we're really in for a treat, and I'm definitely excited about what we're going to talk about. Now, the discussion we are going to have is about the Vietnam War 40 years later. So we're going to look at it in retrospect, sort of what that war meant then, what it means to us now, what we learned. And as we go through that and we look at things, obviously there's a lot of different ways we can take this. So we'll save some time for question and answer at the end. But I think it's definitely best to start at the beginning and walk forward in time. Brad, I wonder if you could start us off and just tell us kind of how you think we should best kind of think about how this war started, really from its origins.
Well, I think, you know, for many Americans, for most of us in this room, the Vietnam War began one day in the early 1960s. That's how we often think of it. And what I've tried to suggest, especially in my most recent book, Embers of War, is that, in fact, we've got to go back much further. I argue in the book that World War II is of immense importance, it seems to me, in giving us what becomes this 30-year struggle. It's really 30 years, a struggle for Indochina, if you will, from 1945 to 75. And World War II, and then the French War that follows, it seems to me, are of great importance to the American War, even if that's our concern principally here today. And I guess I would summarize it this way, that it's about the domino theory, in part, in terms of the early American involvement. Long before Eisenhower coined that phrase, or used that phrase in a press conference in 1954, Americans were thinking in domino theory terms, which is to say, they believed, when the French were fighting their war, that if Indochina were lost to the communists, that it would start a process whereby these other countries would then, quote unquote, fall. And in the early years, I think there's real importance to this. I used to be quite dismissive of it because, in fact, the domino theory is kind of goofy when you think about it. We can discuss that. But I think there was real power to that argument. By the time we get into Kennedy and Johnson, I think it's replaced by what is sometimes called a psychological domino theory, which is to say an emphasis on credibility. It's now not so much about individual countries falling like dominoes. It's about American credibility, American prestige. What will other countries think of us and of our power and of our credibility if we allow, again, in this case, South Vietnam to fall? And I think for the Kennedy and Johnson administrations, that matters enormously. Last thing I'll say is that I think, for me, what I've learned in my many years of doing research on this is that you cannot understand America's war in Vietnam without paying attention to domestic politics and to the power of domestic politics, and that Democrats in particular, so here we're talking about Kennedy and Johnson, Democrats felt vulnerable to charges from Republicans, and to some extent from conservative Democrats, vulnerable to charges that they were soft on communism if they allowed this to happen, that is to say, for the war to be lost. And I think it conditioned what a succession of administrations felt. You could make an argument that for all of the presidents who dealt with Vietnam in a serious way, that's Truman through Ford, I guess. So what is that? Six of them, I think. For all six of them, Vietnam mattered to a large extent because of the damage it could do to their domestic political position.
And I think it's something we pretty quickly can realize too, that, you know, especially if we look at more recent wars, you don't always sometimes realize the importance of the prologue for a conflict. I mean, it's probably easy to sit there and see something like the Gulf War today and how that connects with the Iraq War, and then that, you know, but when you look at Vietnam, we can see something similar. But can you take a second to talk more about how France really fits into this and what some of the concerns were if France sort of pulled out? Not just that if we lose Indochina, but how France fits into this and then the larger geopolitics that really went into this.
Yeah, it's a very good question. And I do think that the French and the decision to back the French was of great importance. Remember, France comes out of World War II humiliated. The Nazis had overrun France in 6 weeks. The Japanese had then taken advantage by swooping into Southeast Asia and taking control of Indochina, at least real control. And the French were determined after the war to reclaim their grandeur, their great power position, and that meant that they had to take Indochina back. And I suggest in the book, that there's actually an open moment there when the Americans could have made a different decision. We know from the French archives that the French were very concerned that the United States would choose to live up to the principles of the Atlantic Charter, which was basically in favor of self-determination for these colonies, and they, the French, would be thwarted by what was now the most powerful nation in the world, namely the United States. And so the French were worried about this. And I think that, in fact, in one of the great what-ifs of this story, if FDR had lived even into 1946 and 47, he, as an outspoken opponent of French colonialism, might have worked to prevent a French return, might have succeeded, and thereby changed the course of history. What happened, of course, is that Truman did not make that decision. The Americans backed the French war to the hilt. By the end of the French war, shortly before the French defeat, the United States is paying for three quarters of the French war effort. The Americans are actually more committed, think about this, more committed to the French war than are the French. So we have very good evidence that the Americans basically say to the French in 1953 and 1954, you've got to stay in, when the French want to negotiate a way out. So it's very important. And then, and I won't go into the details here, but one could certainly say, I would say, that to a considerable degree, the American, Bernard Fall made this point very powerfully. We could talk about Bernard Fall. The Americans are walking basically in the same footsteps of the French. So a great number of the problems that the French encountered, the Americans would encounter later. And in fact, you could wonder, why is it that Americans chose not to reflect on the lessons that the French war taught?
And, you know, as we kind of, you know, especially with the theme of this conference being so much about U.S. presidents, and there's this presidential drama, if you will, with Indochina's unfolding with Truman and Eisenhower. It certainly starts to really involve the United States. Of course, this is all unfolding not only before I'm a zygote, but before my parents are zygotes. So, I mean, maybe certainly some of the folks in the audience were alive then and can sort of speak to this. But, Jack, I mean, do you, as we start shifting towards the origins of American involvement in the more active phases, I mean, do you sort of want anything you want to offer in terms of the sentiments you felt?
You brought up a couple of, and I may be completely wrong, and you're the scholar about it, but didn't we have an advisory effort with Ho Chi Minh during the Second World War to help Ho Chi Minh drive the Japanese out?
Yeah. No, and it's...
Edward Lansdale was there.
And the OSS officers, forerunner to the CIA, the OSS officers who dealt with Ho Chi Minh to a person, at least as far as I've been able to see, admired Ho Chi Minh, thought that the United States could work with Ho Chi Minh, did not want to see the French return, and moreover believed, whatever you think of Ho Chi Minh and his communist inclinations, and he was by then a committed Marxist-Leninist, no question, those OSS officers thought, this is trouble.
And he asked us for help.
This is trouble.
He asked us for help to get rid of the French, and I think for a wide variety of reasons, not the least significant of which was the rightward turn of domestic politics.
Yeah.
We said, no, you're a communist, so we're not going to do it.
Right.
And maybe properly so under those circumstances. When you talk about the importance of domestic politics and how it influences foreign politics, I think you can see it in a lot of places, but in that particular instance, at least as much as any other place.
Yes, I agree.
We started getting fired up, sending people. We had a fairly substantial contingent of special operators and special forces people, principally, to try to train the Vietnamese so that they could resist the Viet Cong relatively early on. I mean, it was Jack Kennedy.
Yeah.
Another interesting question, I mean, you asked the hypothetical question about what would have happened if Roosevelt had lived. What would have happened had Kennedy lived? What would he have done with that mission?
I just wrote an essay on that very question that'll appear in the companion volume to Ken Burns's extraordinary forthcoming documentary. I really want to recommend this to all of you. I think it's going to air in September, if I'm not mistaken. It's in 10 parts, so it's a classic Ken Burns sort of effort. But there's a book that goes along with this that Jeff Ward is writing, but they're also going to have some essays. And I've written one on the question, what would Kennedy have done? Which I think is actually it's an interesting question in a parlor game kind of way, but it also is a historical question, because I think speculating about that question, suppose Oswald misses, I think it was Oswald, suppose he misses, JFK comes back alive, what happens? And so in the essay, I lay out the various possibilities, and I consider the possibility that he would have escalated in the same way that Johnson did, made it an American war. I consider the opposite. Some have suggested that even before his death, he had launched a withdrawal, he had initiated a withdrawal plan. I don't find much evidence for that. I do ultimately conclude that a surviving Kennedy most likely would have avoided the kind of wholesale, large-scale escalation involving rolling thunder, involving the commitment of hundreds of thousands of ground troops. He was a different person than LBJ. I think his skepticism went even deeper than Johnson's. The key decisions would have come in his second term.
Johnson, who was skeptical like 2 microseconds behind the order setting the Marines.
Yeah.
And he said, I'm not sure I did the right thing. This is on tape.
Yeah. Now, there's a great deal of private pessimism on the part of, it seems to me, of almost all of these people.
And the major,
and Nixon.
Major inflection point was that. I mean, up until that point, we had special forces there training indigenous people to resist the bad guys. And it was that point when we sent conventional troops to what was effectively an unconventional war that changed everything.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about, since we're starting to get into the heart of the American phase here, to quote you from last night, both you gentlemen described the beginning of the American efforts in 65 going into the years onward as willy-nilly. So let's discuss that for a little bit. I mean, what's the implications of the Vietnam War in terms of the incremental way that we decided we were going to conduct the war?
Well, you know, you all know, and we talked about this in one of the other sessions, you don't conduct any kind of operation, whether it's a military or business operation, you don't do anything until you first decide what it is you're trying to accomplish. And then you decide what assets you're going to use. To do it any other way is just a recipe for disaster. You may win, you may succeed, but that's just as likely to occur because of happenstance, not because you made intelligent decisions about what to do along the way. No, you got to start at the end and work backwards. We never did that.
Yeah.
The second thing is that was the big influence of domestic politics, and the perception was that domestic politics precluded a large-scale mobilization of the type we had in the Second World War. Yeah. And so we had to take these little baby steps because it was politically infeasible to do what we did in the Second World War just to go to Vietnam. The result of that was little bits and pieces of incremental increase in what our capability was, with no real idea of being able to articulate how we knew when the thing was going to be over, and no allocation of resources sufficient enough to accomplish it. And that problem was exacerbated, so that those stupid decisions, they were kind of, I say they're stupid because they were illogical in terms of what you were trying to do, because we couldn't articulate what it is we were trying to do. They were exacerbated by a situation which we find today in lots of countries in which we're involved, and that is a corrupt government with no particular interest in doing effectively its share to make sure that whatever we were trying to accomplish was going to get done. So we had a reluctant partner, insufficient resources to accomplish the mission, and really no idea what the mission really was. And so we went from one set of troops there to another set of troops there, and incrementally increased the size of the footprint without having any success. At the risk of hogging the conversation.
Well, the thing, I just to add a bit of symmetry. I mean, as I'm hearing you say this, Jack, I mean, it doesn't really sound too different, really, than what the French were doing in the earlier years. And I mean, just to sort of show the parallels. There. I mean, what would you offer, Fred?
Well, I think that the only thing I would add is that part of the reason for this inability, or at least unwillingness, to really figure out in advance what is it that we're trying to do and how do we go about achieving this was because of quite profound doubts, as I think I alluded to this a moment ago, on the part of senior officials. Not just the president himself. If we focus here on the Johnson period, so let's consider the period right before the escalation. Johnson himself doubted, it seems to me, quite clearly, privately, we know this from the Johnson tapes and from other evidence, he doubted that the war could be won. He doubted that it was necessary to try to win the war, which is quite an astonishing assertion, given that he was about to send hundreds of thousands of Americans to fight, and some of them to die in this war. Robert McNamara, often thought of as the hawk among hawks. McNamara, it's clear to me, privately doubted both of these, both that it could be won and that it was necessary to try. I give sort of grudging admiration to Dean Rusk, the Secretary of State, because Rusk, though I think he misunderstood the nature of the Cold War and the communist threat, at least Rusk believed in this thing in a way that so many of the other top leaders did not. So I think one of the reasons why they didn't figure this out is because they weren't on some level sure that this thing was in fact as important as they suggested. And they were not willing, as you quite rightly say, Johnson ruled out the possibility of putting the country on a true war footing. McGeorge Bundy said to him, "Please, Mr. President, we need to tell the American people what it is that we're about to do." Johnson refused. He thought that his Great Society legislation would be threatened. There was this domestic political concern that we've been describing.
Well, he made a speech that said we can have guns and butter. Yes. I mean, many of you remember that. He said, yeah, we can have guns and butter.
Yeah. And then the only last thing I'll say in response to your question is that I do think there is a similarity here between the French and the Americans, that the French likewise had difficulty explaining to themselves, much less to the French people, why this war in far-off Indochina justified the kind of resources that the French were putting into this. There are differences in that the French relied much more on legionnaires, they relied more on indigenous troops, they relied on North African troops. So there are differences between but I don't want to make the distinction, draw the parallel too close between the French and the American wars, but there's certainly that dimension too.
There's another consideration I want to add that we often forget, and that is the role of the people at the top of the military food chain. For those of us who are down at the bottom, every day was just another opportunity to survive. So our view of the strategic imperative here was it went totally over our heads. We were not particularly interested in any of that stuff. We wanted to do our jobs that we were trained to do, take care of each other, and kill or capture the guys to our immediate front. I mean, that's all we cared about. And those of you who've served in combat yourself know that that's true. I mean, the large-scale strategic questions are for people to think about at some other level. But what was the role of the high-ranking people at the top of the military food chain, many of whom, but not all of whom, were combat veterans themselves from the Second World War? What was their view of what could be accomplished? It was a corruption of the notion of can-do. Somebody gives you an opportunity to do something, and you say, I can do it.
Yeah.
And that doesn't work. That doesn't work if you haven't thought about what it is you're trying to do. And a succession of four-star generals continued to say the same thing when they were asked, how many people you need? I need 100,000 more. We're going to give you 30,000 more. Okay, I'll take them. That conversation actually did take place with William Westmoreland being the high-ranking guy. That's not the way you operate a business. That's not the way you operate the defense of the republic. Either 100,000 is the right number or 30,000 is the right. They can't both be the right number. And if, and I'll prattle on just a few seconds more and then shut up.
Please.
When you're in a situation and the boss comes to you and says, I want you to do X in the military, you not only have the authority to put your 2 cents in, you have the responsibility for putting your 2 cents in. But when the decision is actually made, unless the decision is immoral or illegal, no matter how stupid it is, and I've been on the wrong end of lots of stupid tactical decisions. Unless you can convince the guy otherwise, you're going to carry it out. But when you get to be at the top of the military food chain, you have a responsibility for making sure not only don't we do anything immoral or illegal, but we don't do anything stupid. And in that regard, the large majority, matter of fact, almost all, and I can't think of anybody who doesn't fit this category, of people at the top of the military food chain, they all failed to do this. They said yes to everything. And the result is what you saw. I mean, 10 years of war, 58,000 guys killed, and nothing different at the end than was at the beginning.
And William Westmoreland in 1967 returns to Washington twice in the fall of 67 because Johnson is concerned that popular support for the war is going south, which it is. And they launch a campaign. It's called a Progress Campaign. And part of that campaign is to have Westmoreland come back and to tell the American people, we've turned the corner. And in fact, he does. And I think I said this yesterday, but he uses a phrase. He says as follows. We have reached an important moment when the end begins to come into view. And that's a phrase, not exactly the same language, but Henri Navarre, the French commander, used the same language in May of 1953 to suggest that that war had turned the corner. So there is this sense on Westmoreland's part that he's going to do not what Colonel Jacobs is suggesting, but in fact what he's going to do what the president in this case wants him to do. Some of that, of course, is understandable, but I quite agree that in its macro sense, the American effort suffers accordingly.
But it is the French who say the more things change, the more they stay the same. So why shouldn't Westmoreland say that?
So I'm sort of kind of getting two immediate takeaways here. One is that it seems that when senior generals say, you know, we're going to win this about the end is near, we've got a year before it all goes bad. So that's the immediate term. So I'll never use that phrase from here on. But the bigger implication, looking at what I'm hearing both you gentlemen say, is that this idea of strategy in any circumstance short of full-scale mobilization doesn't seem to be something that Western powers have done really all that well since World War II, in part because there really hasn't been the full-scale mobilization. But again, the track record is not very good following the post-45 effort. And so, I mean, you talk about the decisions leaders should make, Jack, and so I wonder, I mean, short of coming to bare conclusions or of doing, sort of following that moral imperative, I mean, is there really a recipe for some of this? And I mean, I don't mean to seem fatalistic, but it seems that we see a lot of the same mistakes being made again and again.
Yeah, what we need to do, of course, is to train people so that they don't grow up to be great and famous Americans in uniform and make the same mistakes. Yeah. But I will tell you that no matter how hard you try, it's extremely difficult to do that. Years ago, when I was your age, I was teaching at West Point, and I was teaching first classmen international relations, and people who grew up to be at the top of the food chain at the time were cadets about ready to graduate. The war in Vietnam had just ended, so we're talking about year group 75, 76. And some of these guys told me, you know, that war in Vietnam was all screwed up, and we learned a lot from it. We cadets learned a lot from that, and the chain of command really messed that up. And mark our words, when we grow up to be four-star generals, we're not going to make the same mistakes. And they grew up to be four-star generals, and they made the same mistakes. There's got to be a way to fix that, and maybe it's insufficient to teach people how to act and what to do when they're 21 years old. They have to be continuously reminded of it, and they have to be well led by the civilian leadership. That's one of the reasons why, whatever else you can say about the current cast of characters in Washington, and I've said this on the air, I'm perfectly happy to see a general officer running the Defense Department. Because that guy, I mean, if you're listening to civilians, don't forget that McNamara, you know, McNamara was in the Second World War. He was a statistician. That's what he did. He worked in an office. He knew no more about waging warfare than your pet pug dog. But maybe if you get military people in the military chain of command, in jobs like the Secretary of Defense, who do have experience, you may have some chance of righting that wrong. But you gotta educate them continuously. You gotta beat them up all the time and remind them of what their obligations are as at the top of the food chain.
I wonder if part of the problem here is, I don't know if you agree with this, but that there's something, I'm just speculating here, there's something seductive about counterinsurgency. And so successive generations say, we're gonna do it differently, we're gonna learn from these mistakes. And maybe one of the lessons here in terms of the legacy of the war for later U.S. interventions is that counterinsurgency is just really difficult. That at best it takes a long time. It also is going to be very expensive. It's going to involve a lot of firepower. As you suggested earlier, your local government, the people on whose behalf you are fighting, need to do their part of the bargain. It's just a very, very difficult proposition, and somehow each generation seems to need to learn it anew.
I don't disagree. There was an interview of Stan McChrystal a couple of years ago when asked, I don't know if it was Afghanistan or asked about Iraq. It's irrelevant. I mean, these are different wars and different people and different arcs and so on, but the concepts in this regard are pretty much the same. Asked him how long do you think, fill in the blank with the country, is this going to take? And he says, well, at least a decade. And we'd already been there a decade. At least a decade. And, of course, like most things, it always takes more resources than you think it does. It's like going in to buy a car. There's a car, and it's this much money. Until you realize that you got to pay extra for the undercoating and the keys and, you know, all of that. Everything's got to, my daughter never listened to anything I said. She lives in New York City, and she and her husband were talking years ago about getting a car. I said, a car? You live in New York City? Are you out of your mind? She says, no, we need a car to get around. Lived across the street from, she said, we need to get out into the green area. I said, live across the street from Central Park. I mean, that's green. No, we need a car so we can go on weekends and go places. I said, you do realize what it costs to maintain a car. You got to buy the car, so you got the depreciated cost of that car over time. You've got all the gas and oil and stuff, all the service you got to put, and you got to park it too, by the way. And then you got to get to where you're parking it. That's not cheap in New York either, even with Uber. And then you got insurance, and you got undercoating and schmundercoating and so on. I calculated for that it is cheaper every weekend to hire a limo and a driver to go wherever you want than it is to own a car in New York City. I mean, she's a kid, and she's not going to listen to her parents, and as a result, they bought a car, and they still have cars years later. Even though you do understand how much extra it's going to cost to accomplish the mission, you don't understand how much it's going to cost. And I'll throw one other thing out there. And I talked about this, I think, in another session, about the reserves. Some of you in the financial, but you always need reserves. You need reserves in the military because you can't predict the future. You might go make an attack, and one of two things is going to happen. You're either going to win or you're going to lose. In both cases, you need a reserve because you can't predict the future. So you've got to assume it's going to take X and add some extra because you're going to need a reserve, either to bail you out of a difficult situation or to reinforce success, but nobody thinks about that. So not only, it's a long-winded way of saying, agree with you completely. Stan McChrystal agrees with you completely. When we talk about resources, we're not just talking about people and money or anything else. We're talking about all that plus time. When today's gone, it's gone forever, and you can't get it back. And so that's a resource, too. And unlike people who can go into a battle and maybe survive it, you can use them again. When today's gone, it's gone forever, and you can't get it back. Once that time goes, that resource of time goes, that's not coming back anymore, and you can't use it again. And I think we still don't understand that. A few people do, but the National Command Authority doesn't understand it.
Well, there's definitely also a political difficulty with selling the true costs of counterinsurgency in not only financial, but in time. I mean, it's really tough to have any administration say, should we do this? It's going to be a decision for the next seven presidents to wrestle with. And that's definitely something that I don't think is ever certainly broadcast publicly when, you know, we discuss something like that.
Yeah, and it's just really hard, it seems to me. It's very hard for let's say, an indigenous people to see an army of occupation as its friend. And I think this was a problem in Vietnam, again, for the French, but it was also a problem for the Americans, because Americans didn't realize that in the eyes of many Vietnamese, there's really not that much difference between the French and now the Americans, because there's an army of occupation in both instances.
And their perception, the Vietnamese perception of time was very much different than ours, because they've been fighting since, who knows, all they knew was fighting. You go to Afghanistan today, that's all they do is fight. Yeah. Whether we're there or we're not there, that's what they do. In the Vietnamese, and we had a completely different view. We had individual replacement in Vietnam. We don't do that anymore because individual replacement's really stupid. Even so, we have the political imperative to get in and get out. An individual replacement went to Vietnam, you were there for 1 year, and you came home either after 1 year or on a litter, or in a body bag. But in a year, you were through with it, or less, you were finished. So on average, people lasted 6 months there. They were there, they were lifers, and the Vietnamese were lifers in Vietnam. And we understood it, but it was something like, I'm trying to think of an analogy. You go someplace and the food is really disgusting. The indigenous people really like eating grubs. Well, they're kind of like used to eating grubs. That's what they eat. That's what they like. You don't. You're interested in eating lasagna or kreplach or whatever it happens to be. And grubs is not exactly on. No, I'm not going to do it. Your view of life, your view of the environment is very, very much different than the indigenous people. And one of the things that we're interested in doing is getting out as quickly as possible. And you can't inflict that on other people because they're not going to buy it.
That's true. So one of the things what I want to talk about before we open this up to questions is that we said we'd talk about what this war means and what we learned from it. So just to pick either one or both, but surely to address that before we open up to questions, Fred, how would you respond?
I guess I would give two rather different responses in terms of the legacy of the war. or what we might learn from the war. One, in the more narrow terms of geopolitics, is that it seems to me that what Vietnam demonstrates is that American power, no matter how great in relative terms, is ultimately limited. And connected to that, that this war, like all wars, had to be won politically if it was to be won at all. And that was a problem. And we've talked about the weakness of the South Vietnamese government. There were, and Jack can speak to this better than I can, there were South Vietnamese who were dedicated, courageous, who fought hard for South Vietnam. I don't mean to suggest otherwise. There just weren't enough of them. And there were too many problems on the South Vietnamese side. So that's one thing that I would say. The second is a rather different legacy. And it's one that saddens me, which is that I think that the war had a very significant role to play in causing us to become cynical of government, to become mistrustful of government. I'm writing a biography right now of John F. Kennedy. And it's a life and times biography. It's going to be warts and all. There are going to be certain aspects of Kennedy that I will be critical of. But Kennedy represented, and by the way, he had responsibility for helping to make the Vietnam War happen. But nevertheless, Kennedy, I think, he reminds Americans of a time in which it was possible to believe that government could be a force for good, that this could be, your life could be about something bigger than yourself, that it was possible to have very high aspirations as in terms of politics and in terms of government. John F. Kennedy inspired people, and I think that's one of his singular legacies. How does that connect to Vietnam? I think because of Vietnam, because of what became known as the credibility gap of Johnson's, Nixon's problems, to say the least, Americans became understandably cynical. We moved from being naive about politics and government, which is brings its own problems, although I'd rather have naivete, if I had to choose something, than extreme cynicism. And so that legacy, which we're grappling with still, is regrettable.
Would you say we went from naivete to cynicism and nothing in between? I mean, we didn't stop and learn anything.
Yeah.
It's interesting about Kennedy. I was just thinking about this as you were talking about your biography. I was in college when Kennedy was killed, and so our view of him is that he's perpetually 42 years old.
Yeah.
And so you have a mistaken view of all of that time period since then. Kennedy were alive today, he would be
99.
He'd be 100. He'd be 100 this year.
100 in about 3 months.
100 years old. That changes your view of things. I agree with you completely. I think one of the things we should have learned but didn't learn is that there is a big difference between strategy and tactics. And until we can distinguish between them, I think we're going to continue to make national security mistakes.
Okay, so that leaves us with about 10 minutes or so. So we'll open it up for questions. So just I'll repeat your question after you ask it, just so everyone can hear it. So, sir in blue. So the question for everyone was, given the responsibilities and requirements for credibility of senior military officers, should that be a requirement for a president? Gentlemen?
Do you want to?
Yeah, I will.
A better leader.
Sure.
Not necessarily. We've had presidents who have had military experience and they were lousy. And we've had presidents who've had no military experience and they were great. I think it's not an independent variable. I, for one, believe in universal service, so I'd like to see everybody having served. But that's a separate story altogether. So it pays your money and takes your choice.
Yeah, I would agree. And certainly also agree on the question of universal service. There's an interesting discussion we ought to have.
Just to offer my two cents, the only thing I thought deeply on that question, the one thing I would notice is that when it comes to military credentials, does that help you one or another? Certainly agree with Colonel Jacobs. The only thing I'll say is that it does seem to be a surprising thing that when the senior-most generals, such as Washington or Grant, come into power, they have an interesting way of disappointing all the belligerent, bellicose ambitions of the services who think money is just going to flow in, and they do things that do tend to surprise the services. But there tends to be a reservation there, I think is because they've already kind of gone as far as they can go militarily. There's nothing they're chasing. So there's a little bit of wisdom that I think I see, when it comes from the senior most generals that have followed in the presidency.
I might just add 30 seconds or less, which is that I do think, and again, I'm very immersed in John F. Kennedy right now. I do think that JFK's World War II service in the Pacific, to a greater degree than I thought when I started my research, and so this will be at least a sub-theme in my biography, his World War II service is very, very important in terms of conditioning his view later of international politics, and especially of the prospect of war in the nuclear age. And so I think, though I wouldn't want to draw a straight line between his service in the war and the outcome of the Cuban Missile Crisis, I think we can be grateful for the fact that JFK was president during the missile crisis and that his response to the discovery of Soviet missiles in Cuba was, again, conditioned by what he experienced and his belief that we've got to, whatever we do, avoid a kind of nuclear conflagration at this point.
Sir.
Yes. Can we go back to the end of World War II and focus on the Dulles brothers, okay? They were probably two of the most despicable people in the history of this country.
They've got a lot of competition.
Tell us what you really think. Yeah.
So I'll just repeat the question, and Fred, I know you, I pretty much know you're going to answer this one. So given how World War II ended, how did the Dulles brothers and their, as you said it, sir, their zealous pursuit of communism as sort of a replacement for Nazi Germany, how did that sort of affect the way that they interacted with Ho Chi Minh?
Yeah, I would say a couple of things. One is that periodization matters, so that John Foster Dulles, as Secretary of State, really becomes important not right after World War II, as you know, but really in 1954 and 55. So it matters here when we're talking about this. I would concur with you that the two brothers are very important in this story. 1954, the French have been defeated at one of the great military encounters in modern history, namely the Battle of Dien Bien Phu. At least symbolically, the defeat for the French in this war. Eisenhower and Dulles face a very important decision. That's John Foster Dulles, the Secretary of State. Alan Dulles is the director of the CIA. So they are a very formidable duo, as you say. And it's another one of these, what ifs, or at least another one of these turning points. In 54, President Eisenhower and his Secretary of State make the fateful decision to try to succeed where the French have failed. So what they're going to do is to build up a non-communist bastion in the southern part of Vietnam. They're going to support this bastion, and they're going to create, hopefully, a permanent non-communist entity in the southern part of Vietnam. Hugely important decision. And as you say, it's against Ho Chi Minh and his revolution. And if we're going to talk then about the key signposts on the road to America's war. This is one of them, and for that reason, Dulles, not the most imaginative thinker in the world, smart guy, but he tended to think very narrowly about these things, as you suggested. I think he looms very large.
Ma'am, all the way in the back. So I'm going to try to very quickly synthesize it. So, I mean, given the way we've interconnected domestic and foreign policy, is there really a objective fashion in which senior military officials are looking at this, but not just at the highest levels, but, I mean, at the lowest levels? And are they teaching it? So what I will just say is, having taught recently at West Point and being at mid-level education right now for the military, there are discussions of these things. I don't know how effective the education is at this level, given that, again, like as you've said, Colonel Jacobs, I mean, again, the education has to continue. I certainly am not senior enough to have been educated as a senior military official, but gentlemen,
well, I taught at the National War College, and the short answer is yes. All that stuff is taught at increasing levels of sophistication. And there's a selection process so that, in theory, your best qualified people to move on to the next level of command and staff, those are the people who go to these schools. You get selected for them. But it's like anything else. Once, it's like your kids. You wind them up, and they go out the door. You've done the best you can, and there's no guarantee they're going to listen. They'll do any of the things that you taught them to do over the previous 22 years. Same thing is true of military officers, and the same thing is true in just about any walk of life. What we need to do is make sure that we create a culture of professionalism so that the things they will have been taught get retained and used later on.
Yeah.
We're actually not that bad at it, but it's a lot of work.
Class that I taught last year, I had five or six, they're called National Security Fellows. They're sent to Harvard for 1 year. I had them in my class. And one of the themes in my class was precisely what we're talking about here, the interconnection between domestic politics and foreign policy. They were, the five or six of them, absolutely superb. Now, they're hand-selected, they're, you know, specially selected by the military, so it stands to reason that they'll be very impressive men and women, and boy, were they ever. And what I found striking was the degree to which they were not surprised by this theme in the class, they were not troubled by it. I think they had encountered, as Jack says, in their previous education, this kind of discussion. I think it is being taught. It seems to be absorbed. The question is, as you're saying, when they are in command, and some of them I'm sure will be, you know, will it be reflected in the decisions they make?
A good analogy is when, we're going to run out of time here. A good analogy is when you're in combat. You go to school, you go to basic course and jump school and ranger school, and all. You learn all these tactical imperatives, all the things you're supposed to do, all the things you're not supposed to do. You practice them over and over and over again, and then you're supposed to do it that way when people are ardently trying to kill you. And most of the time you do, and sometimes you don't. Different situation than being in school.
So with just a couple seconds, you know, we have left, I was going to, you know, thank the distinguished members of the panel. I certainly was honored and humbled to be among them and have this discussion with you. The one thing that I was going to leave you with, what I think the war in Vietnam really meant the most 40 years later, it goes back to what Colonel Jacobs said, but understand the difference between strategy and tactics. When I went home today at noon, took off the uniform, put a bathing suit on, played with my daughter, and started thinking about something, about the fact that in the Steinbeck room, you have Travis Mills, a quadruple amputee from the war in Afghanistan, who's here speaking concurrently while we are, and that I was playing with my daughter. And I thought about the enormity of the American cost in the war in Vietnam. Rough estimate has it around 50,000 killed in Vietnam. And that the number of killed, of course, in the war in Afghanistan, war that's gone in Afghanistan and Iraq, a war that's gone on for about 16 years. And I thought about the order of magnitude different. And I think that one of the things is, as we look at the symmetry between the French experience, the American experience in Vietnam, American experiences abroad currently, there's a lot of congruencies. But I am thankful in a very visceral way, for at least at the tactical level, the way we've seemed to have focused on learning from those lessons a little bit, advances in tactics and medical care and the such. But again, I think the biggest things we've talked about largely are the same, so I'm not so sure how greatly we've learned.
Let me just say, I know we're out of time, but we should also then be mindful. I agree with everything you've said, but we should be mindful of the Vietnamese losses.
Absolutely.
You know, we're talking about 58,000 American dead, we're talking about 300,000 American injured, we're talking about 75,000 Americans left permanently disabled, but the Vietnamese losses were proportionately 100 times greater than the American losses. And as we were discussing, the numbers are hard to come by, but we could be talking about between 1.5 million Vietnamese deaths and 3 million Vietnamese deaths, the significant majority of them civilians. So,
and the ratios are similar for the current wars today. When we talk about Afghanistan and Iraq. So anyway, thank you so much for all of you who came. I appreciate it. And give the panelists a round of applause.